Hello everyone, welcome to the session on tariff and non-tariff barriers to trade. Even though there are persuasive arguments in favor of free trade and free trade as an instrument of economic growth, a number of countries have adopted various forms of protection. By protection, we mean the policy whereby domestic industries are protected from foreign competition. A number of arguments have been adopted in favor of protection. Maybe the oldest doctrine is the infant industry argument by Frederick List and Alexander Hamilton, in which they argue that industries at their infancy stage must be protected. There are other arguments like key industries argument, terms of trade argument, employment argument, defense argument, and so on. In this video, we will examine the meaning of tariff, the types of tariff, the effect of tariff, the concept of optimum tariff, and a theory dealing with tariff, namely Stolper-Samuelson theorem. Welcome to the video. Thus, we have two methods or forms of protection. One is tariff, the other is non-tariff barriers. Tariff is considered as one of the most important form of protection. It is defined as a tax, levy or duty imposed on commodities when it crosses national boundaries. Obviously, commodity will cross national boundary when we export as well as when we import. So, we have two kinds of tariff. One is known as the import tariff as well as it's an export tariff. But as a form of protection, only import tariff can be considered. So here onwards, when we talk about tariff, actually we are implying only the import tariff. It's a price-based measure because tariff is imposed on the price of the commodity. Looking at the various types of tariff, broadly speaking, we have three different kinds of classification on the basis of purpose, on the basis of discrimination, and on the basis of retaliation. On the basis of purpose, you can have two types. One is the revenue tariff, where the tariff is designed to provide more revenue to the government. If the objective of the tariff is to protect domestic industries as well as to encourage domestic production and discourage import, we call it as protective tariff. And we have three different types of protective tariff. If tariff is imposed on the basis of the physical measurement of the commodity, we call it as specific tariff, like liter, ton, etc. If tariff is imposed as per the value of the commodity being traded, we have ad valorem tariff. Compound tariff is the combination of specific as well as ad valorem. Now, moving to the second classification, that is on the basis of discrimination. If tariff is imposed as a uniform rate, that is, uniform rate of tariff is imposed on all similar commodities, irrespective of the country of origin, it is known as the single column tariff. That is, in the case of single column tariff, there is no country-wise discrimination, it's a non-discriminatory tariff. On the other hand, if two different rates of tariff exist for the same or similar commodity, we have a double column tariff. If more than two rates of tariff exist for same or similar commodity, we have a multiple column tariff. Moving to the third classification on the basis of retaliation. Retaliatory tariff is imposed as a retaliation against other countries whose trade policy harms our country or our exports. Countervailing duty is imposed as an additional duty on commodities whose export prices are reduced when government provide them export subsidy. That is, to offset the impact of subsidies, to offset the ability of the traders to reduce their prices, the country can impose a countervailing duty, which is known as countervailing duty. Now, moving to the effect of tariff, there are three partial effects of tariff. The immediate effect of tariff is obviously price effect. That is, when a tariff is imposed on imported commodity, the first direct effect is that the price in the domestic market will increase. When price increases, domestic consumption of the commodity will decline, which is the consumption effect. When price of this commodity increases, domestic producers will now try to produce this commodity domestically. That is, domestic production of this imported commodity will increase. It is the production effect. Revenue effect accrues to the government because tariff is a duty, it's a tax, it's a revenue for the government. Revenue of government will increase when it imposes tariff. Balance of trade effect is a positive because tariff affects the quantity imported. It is expected that quantity imported will decline. There is no influence on quantity exported. So balance of trade defined as X minus M will improve, will be favorable for the importing country. When you talk about the welfare effect of tariff, we can identify at least three branches or three segments of the population. One, the producers, two, the consumers, and third, the government. For consumer, the welfare obviously will reduce because there's a price effect. Price will increase domestically. So it is against the interest of the consumer as far as the imposition of tariff is concerned. For the producers, it's good in the sense that there is the production effect, domestic production of this commodity increases. For the government, obviously, the revenue will increase. So tariff is against the interest of the consumers, but it is favorable for producers as well as the government. Now, looking at the concept of optimum tariff. Optimum tariff is the rate of tariff that maximizes country's welfare. You can see in that figure, when tariff rate is zero, there is no tariff, we call it as a free trade. When tariff rate increases, welfare also increases. And when welfare reaches maximum, that rate of tariff is known as optimum tariff. In that figure, the T star is the optimum tariff because it maximizes the welfare of the country. When country goes on imposing tariff even after the optimum tariff, then welfare will decline. When it reaches T0, the tariff become prohibitive. Prohibitive tariff in the sense that its causes trade to be zero. There will not be any trade when tariff rate is such a high as prohibitive tariff. So optimum tariff is defined as those tariff that maximizes welfare of the country. After optimum tariff, welfare will decline. Now, moving towards one of the celebrated theorem as far as the imposition of tariff is concerned is Stolper-Samuelson theorem. Wolfgang Stolper, Paul Anthony Samuelson introduced this theory in their work Protection and Real Wages, published in the year 1941. Basically, this theory analyzes the income effect of tariff. Then later, this theory was used to explain the income effect of international trade in general. The theory says that an increase in the relative price of the commodity as a result of imposition of tariff will raise the return or earnings of the factor intensively used in the production of the commodity. In other words, when a country imposes tariff, the return of country's scarce factor of production will increase and the return of abundant factor of production will decline. That is, international trade will reduce the income of the abundant factor as well as it will increase the income of the scarce factor of production. It enhances country's welfare, but the gains from trade are not necessarily equally distributed because it is more favorable to country's scarce factor of production because the income of the scarce factor of production may be growing over time. Now, we will use a tool called Edgeworth box diagram to explain Stolper-Samuelson theorem. Our economic students will be familiar with this tool since they have extensively used this concept in their microeconomics course. But for our commerce fraternity, they might skip this diagrammatic exposition. Now, we are using a case of country 2, which is a capital abundant country. In our earlier session on the modern theory of international trade or the Heckscher-Ohlin model, we saw that country 2 is assumed as a capital abundant country. This country specializes in the production of commodity Y, which is a capital intensive commodity, and this country imports commodity X. Now we are going to see a situation in which this country imposes a tariff on commodity X. What happens to the return to factors of production? We take the example of country 2, which is a capital abundant as well as scarce labor scarce country. Now, it imports commodity X. Now, we have 3 points here. Point A denotes the autarky production point. Point B represent the free trade production point. And point F represent production point with 100% tariff on commodity X. Can be seen that production F or the point F is further away from the origin of OX and close to the origin OY than B, indicating that when this country imposes tariff, country 2 now produces more of commodity X. We know that commodity X is a labor intensive commodity. To produce more X, you need more labor. As a result, it leads to increased demand of labor and increased wage rate in the country. That is, as a result of imposition of tariff, it benefits country's scarce factor of production, which is labor in our example. The solid as well as dashed lines from OX as 2 and OY represent the capital labor ratio in the production of X and Y. We can see that from point F, it is more biased towards capital, indicating that in the point F, the capital labor ratio in the production of commodity X increases. That is, not only real wage, but also money wage as well as real wage increases. So that not only the nominal reward, but also real reward of this scarce factor of increases. So basically, Stolper-Samuelson theorem examined the redistributive effect of tariff. It says that the scarce factor benefit at the expense of country's expensive factor production. Now, one specific model or theory that went against the Stolper-Samuelson theorem, called the exception of Stolper-Samuelson theorem, is what is known as the Metzler paradox. Discovered by Metzler in the year 1949 in his work Tariff and Terms of Trade and the Distribution of National Income. Metzler criticized the Stolper-Samuelson theorem for assuming that the terms of trade of the tariff imposing country will remain unchanged. Metzler pointed out that when a country imposes tariff, it can lead to such an improvement in country's terms of trade so that as a result of imposition of tariff, the prices of the imported commodity might decline rather than increase as envisaged in the case of Stolper-Samuelson theorem. His argument is that when the price of the imported good fall as a result of an improvement in terms of trade, then the relative price of the exportable good might increase. It's an unusual case when tariff lowers rather than raises the relative price of the importable commodity. So it will be more profitable to produce the exportable commodity, and the income of the scarce factor of production will fall when there is a Metzler paradox. Exact opposite of the Stolper-Samuelson theorem. Stolper-Samuelson theorem says that when a country imposes tariff, it benefits country's scarce factor of production. But Metzler points out that when there is an improvement in the terms of trade, when country imposes tariff, it benefits country's abundant factor of production. It's an opposite of the Stolper-Samuelson theorem. That's why we call it as a paradox. Having explained the nature of tariff, we move on to the analysis of non-tariff barriers to trade, or what is popularly known as the new protectionism. NTBs are basically distortions of international trade. Most of the NTBs took the form of administrative measures where the governments try to discriminate against the foreign goods and in favor of domestic commodities. Now, let us examine various matters related to the non-tariff barriers to trade. The non-tariff barriers, like tariff, restrict the flow of international trade as well as benefit from specialization in production and trade. It's also called the new protectionism, refers to the proliferation of NTBs since 1970s. Most often, NTBs used as a disguised method to obstruct international trade because it can be used without having a proper notice or care from our trade partner. Now, let us look into various types of non-tariff barriers. It includes import quotas, voluntary export restraints, technical, administrative and other regulations, export subsidies, dumping, as well as international cartel. As we said, most of the NTBs took an administrative measure form. tries to discriminate against the foreign commodities in favor of the domestically produced goods. Now let's look into the import quota, or what is known as the quota system. It's a direct quantitative restriction on the amount of commodity to be imported. It aims at restricting and regulating the imports in order to protect domestic industries or to correct the disequilibrium in balance of payment. Basically, import quotas are very similar to tariff. Most of the effects are similar except the revenue effect. Because in the case of tariff, since it's a tax, it's a duty imposed by the government, there is a revenue effect, and revenue will be allotted to the government, or government can attain revenue when it imposes tariff. But in the case of quota, there is no such revenue. So the effect of tariff and quota are the same except the revenue effect. Now, there are various types of quota. For example, tariff quota. Under tariff quota, a given quantity of commodity is permitted to import duty-free or with a very small percentage of tariff or levy. But imports of excess of that quantity will be charged at a high rate of tariff. Under unilateral quota, the total quantity or value of the commodity imported is fixed by the government without any agreement with other countries. But in the bilateral quota, quotas are fixed with some agreement with other countries. In mixing quota, the quota of raw materials to be imported are fixed by the government. That is, the domestic producers should use the imported raw material up to a certain proportion along with the domestic raw materials. Under import licensing, the amount or the quantity to be imported is mentioned by the order by an appropriate authority. That is, there will be a license which will be provided by the an appropriate authority in which it will specify the quantity to be imported. Most often, this license will be provided to the registered exporters. The voluntary export restraints emerges as a result of certain political consideration. Here, an importing country induces another country or requests another country to reduce their exports of the commodity voluntarily. But there is also a threat of all-round trade restrictions. That is, if this request is not accepted by the other country, this country can impose some kind of trade restriction, can impose tariff or quota system. Can also be an agreement by an exporting country, exporters of government with other importing country to limit their exports to it. If VER, voluntary export restraints, are successful, it will have very same effect of that of import quotas. Technical, administrative and other regulations include safety regulation, health regulation, labeling requirement, environmental consideration and so on. Because most of the multilateral trade agreements allow the government to protect their domestic consumers and citizens from impurities and sources of disease by enforcing health, environmental and safety standards. But the problem with this method is that these restrictions most often act as a veil, or restrictions can be an excessive in some instances, and it includes large amount of the element of protection. Export subsidies are direct payment or granting of a tax relief and subsidized loan to the country's exporters to promote exports, or it may be the low interest loans to the foreign buyer so as to stipulate the country's export. Most often, export subsidies are illegal by international transaction, but even though many countries provide them in a disguised or not so disguised manner, because while when we provide the export subsidy, it can lower the firm's cost through its subsidy and can make domestic firms most cost competitive, leading to the expansion of output. That is, this can be imposed when an export subsidy is prevalent, the other countries can use what is known as the countervailing tariff. Dumping is a sale of commodity in a foreign country at a low price than the domestic market. Or it is the export of the commodity at below cost, or at least the sale of commodity at a lower price abroad than domestically. There can be three types of dumping, and most often the monopolist due the dumping, and it can be persistent dumping, predatory and sporadic. Persistent dumping is a continuous sale of a commodity at a lower price in the foreign market, while predatory dumping is a temporary sale in the foreign market at a low price just to drive out the competitors. Sporadic dumping is an occasional sale of a commodity in a foreign country at a low price just to offload the unsold stock. Thus, persistent dumping is a continuous process. Predatory dumping is a temporary process. The sporadic dumping is an occasional process. But anti-dumping legislations are common and are sanctioned under Article 6 of the GATT 1994, which is the Trade in Goods Related Agreement of World Trade Organization. Finally, the International Cartel. International Cartel is an organization of suppliers of a commodity located in different countries. It can be even a group of governments that agree to restrict the output and export of the commodity with the aim of maximizing joint profit of the organization. There can be two types of cartel. There can be centralized cartel as well as market sharing cartel. Examples are Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, OPEC, as well as International Air Transport Association, IATA. And the existence of international cartel, like any other form of NTBs, obstruct the flow of international trade and represent a major threat in the global trading system. Thus, we have seen that though international institutions call for reduction in tariff as well as elimination in NTBs, it is a fact that both of them influences global trade in a substantial way. Hope that this video is useful to you. You can always visit our blog www.skpeco.blogspot.in. Until next time, stay safe, happy learning. Thank you.